Hello everybody and welcome to another episode of Jack Wall Let's Play Euro Truck Simulator 2. We had a little bit of a glitch a minute ago, which is why I'm jumping into the game here. So I went back to a save. Don't do that very often, but I needed to do it here. So we're going to pop into the job market and pretend that everything is normal. Cambridge is where we're at, and there are 23 tons of potatoes to bring. Not so interested in potatoes. Poland over to Warsaw. Olsen is there. That's tanks. Hamburg 25 is a nice short run. But what's in London? Because we've been to London. London has got 60 to Munich. Okay. Southampton has got 81 to Krakow. Cambridge it might be, and potatoes to Bruno. It's not the best runs there. Lille, no. Netherlands. London again. 60 with a thing to Munich. And it is, but it's an important delivery, and it's a class 680R. Nah, I mean Cambridge, it probably makes sense to just come out of Cambridge, right? Bruno, Czech Republic, that's kind of a direction that we would want to go. Trailer looks ugly, but it's a standard everything else, so we'll set the GPS for that, and it's got 10 hours 35 minutes. So now the real thing here would be if I can sleep. It's raining, it looks like. And now if I can get going in time. See if I can make the pickup. And the pickup should be in here, it seems. And I might have a number of trailers here, so if I've missed that one, I can get the next. But I got 1 hour and 22 minutes, and it's 56. So we'll have to take it. And there she be, the truck. Kind of a split level double container jobby. Nothing fancy, but 60 grand is 60 grand. Click, we are connected. Popping out for a minute just to have a look. Yeah, she's nothing fancy. Nothing fancy is okay though. We've got a job, we are working, we need fuel. We're good for a little while though. So, nice weather in Cambridge here. Raining. Oh, those trucks are coming around very tight there on that turn. Your man's making them just inside the curb. Oh my god. So, a quick look at what we're doing. We are bringing 23 tons of potatoes. We've got good weight. Fruit and veg tends to be heavy though. And we are going to the left here. Stay over in this lane here. We've got plenty of time to get there. We've got 1500, almost 1600 kilometers to run, so we get a bit of mileage out of this as well, which is going to help us. That's going to bring us over the 70, I think. You're not going to crash into me, are you, truck? No. It'll bring us over the 70,000. which will bring us very close to a lifetime of 100,000. But we've got a little bit more to do on this particular truck. 30 is close to 50, so I should be okay, so long as I don't overdo it from here. I'm close to that barrier too. Alrighty then. Maybe we can push it out of here now. We're 60, so I can shove her out to about 80. Get over into this location so that it's a better situation. And we are good to go. We will need fuel. We're good for 500 kilometers. I think that number might drop down quite quickly. 23 tons is not exactly a light load. Coupled with the weight of the truck and everything else going on. Trailer. This is our turn here anyway, so... Wet conditions, hasn't been raining for a little while. Road could be a little bit slippy. But patch 1.9 version 20 is, I mean they've jumped revisions during their building and all the rest. But nevertheless, that's a good 4 or 5, maybe even 6 revisions that have been released into the public beta, and are being downloaded and used. So this is fairly significant stuff overall. I think we're generally looking at decent improvements. Obvious stuff in the AI has improved. Plenty of opportunity to continue improving it. We're going to go in here for some fuel, folks. We're going to fill up with Lolly because I just never trust your computer on your car. Although in fairness to them, they're pretty decent. They're pretty good guides. Right, what are we paying for diesel? 139. Not that bad. It's 139, but it's 159. Did that say 159 or 139? Diesel is 139.9. And that's 159. Now today, based on the exchange rate that the world operates on, give or take, the current run rate between the Great British Pound at 139 is, I'm going to tell you now in a minute because I have it on my mobile phone, don't phones do everything, that's 166, and that's 160 here, so that's actually damn near accurate enough for the purposes of the game. It's 166 as of the 21st of March 2014. So that's all is good. Looks like it might have stopped raining whilst I've been in here too. Oh no, it isn't. So we will be filling her up good-o. We're not going to... Yeah, we're just going to fill the tank. And then we're basically done. And filling the tank is going to bring us... Whoa, yeah, should be full about now. Okay. 2,000 euro for 2,000 euro fuel bill. Jeez Louise. That's fairly significant, isn't it? Who says trucking is cheap, huh? Trucking is not cheap. But anyway, we're rolling. And we should have most of our driving time intact still. 10 hours even on 1930, and there are no hour changes for GMT to CET. So basically 7 and 5 is 12, and then 5 more, so it'll be about 5:30 in the morning tomorrow, or close to that, that I will be running out of driving time and will need to pull over. In the meantime, we're on the cruise control and we are driving down the road, in the UK. Still like this game a lot. It's just something about it. I don't know what it is. They hit nails on the right heads or something. Got a bit of roll in the cab going on here again, I feel. Which is good. There were calls on the forums for the physics from the 1.8 patch to be kind of brought back, and there's not been a huge amount of, you know, noise about it, but there have been a few calls for it that I've read, not by the same person or in the same thread. It's such a subjective topic, and I don't by any means suggest that the call is invalid here. There have been some physics mods that came out back in the 1.6 days, and even 1.4, by the highly talented mod community, that were very popular and added cab roll and bounce, and you know, a sense of motion, I suppose, in the cab when you would hit brakes. And there was one mod, there was one mod that you know, was showing the movement of all of the suspension and the cab springs and the cab suspension itself, as in the cab suspension and not the wheel suspension and chassis suspension. And this thing was bouncing around the place to the extent that it just made me look like I'd probably get seasick, or motion sick or whatever. Personally, for me, that was too much, but it was a pretty popular mod, judging by the download rate. And I don't know what, you know, the installed rate would be. I think I actually did download it, but if I use it on my test profile, I'm pretty sure I didn't bring it across, you know, into my game profile. But it does... Am I thinking that I'm seeing a bit of cab roll there, or is it just the turn? It's probably just the turn. I never know when I'm seeing something, and when I think I'm seeing something, or sensing something. But anyway, so that's a 60, and I'm doing 90. Which is 30% more, and it's possibly a little bit too much. Let it roll back towards the 80 mark before we get to the camera, which is coming up here now. And hope that we'll get by. That's 85. Yeah, that's good. We have a stupid amount of money all of a sudden, of course, but notwithstanding that stupid amount of money, I don't really want to pick up any more fines. Because they actually add up quite a bit. They're 550. And I've picked up 4 or 5 of them recently, you know, so that's a tank of fuel. You're braking to let him out, but you're not translating over into the other lane. Improvements with the AI? Yes, there still are. But there'll always be. I don't think SES is ever going to get the AI to be so good. And some people have called out for various attributes to be programmed in, and I agree with all of it. Yeah, if it was possible, and if it is possible, I hope they do. I do fear, however, that there's only so much that SES will be able to do, and I personally have had to reset my expectations, because I did kind of wait for this AI patch as a complete rewrite in full of the AI, and I was expecting to see dramatic changes and the removal of any type of behavior that was a little bit AI-like, so to speak. And I think that was setting an expectation that was a little out of whack. I think, like I've said before, there's been a few areas that were very obvious to improve, and they've been improved. And there's a number of areas that are less obvious that appear to have been improved as well, such as the overtaking maneuvering in most cases. And then I'm sure there's a suite of stuff that, you know, is behind the scenes, which takes just as much effort. But I'm not really holding out for very much more. I think there's tangible improvements here, and as a patch update, I accept it with gratitude. I think SES have just done it again. They've, in a good sense, they've gone ahead and shown us yet again they're committed to the community. They're willing to invest time and effort to update the game and to improve it, and you know, that's more than many developers have done in the past with their games. Has this patch been kind of, you know, if this was a patch that was going to be a charged downloadable content update, clearly there isn't enough to warrant that. But there's rumors, as there always are, that you know, there's another DLC that will be being developed for ETS2, and I say rumors because I've only kind of got slight ideas for it. Now this is ridiculous driving here by the AI. I don't see that in any way as an improvement. He's still out there in that lane, so... Is that a bug? Yeah, it probably is, actually. So we're going back on the tunnel, the channel tunnel, and we're we're going to be in Friends in 30 minutes. Oh dear, excuse me. And I'm considering buying another truck and hiring another driver when I have the dough. I might as well put it to some use and get them working up the system. Must go and have a look at Hans as well and see if he's actually improving, because he hasn't started off with the greatest of great driving. He's got a couple of RTBs with a couple of RTBs with no load and this kind of malarkey, so I must go and see what he's doing with himself. I won't go on again about the ideas for the player management and the hired drivers and improved interaction. I did put up a comment onto the forum or the feedback section of this game, very high level features and wish lists, and A couple of people did reply to my thread. The general response has been in agreement that there is some interest in that. The number of people who've read the post are significant number, 89. So that's kind of encouraging, but not necessarily enough to swing anything. It's not like 10,000 people or something. All you other 9,900 votes, get reading and get posting, and say yes. Brutal, I think is the word. Brutal. These drivers in the real world, they that's just screwed up already. They do this on their mirrors. It's like, how do they do it on the mirrors? With practice, dear Liza. Well, we'll get it up fairly square and decent here now, so... Although that seems to be quite crooked. Alrighty, so if we hit enter, we will have one choice, and that is to go across to Calais. 35 minutes, 300 euro, and by the power of Euro Truck Simulator 2, we are here. Possible travel destinations. Well, we're here already. We don't need to travel any further. We are on the way to Brno. Oh, we're going down to the Czech Republic. We have 1,300 kilometers left. 21 hours to do it within. And 8 hours of driving. At 10:30, 8 brings us down to 6:30 in the morning. So. Got a little bit back. I think that moon has changed as well, has it? I believe that has changed. It's not as halo-y like, although there is still a halo around it. Right. See you later, alligator. Kilometers. Wow. That's a lot. I get about 1,000 out of my car. I was watching a bit of YouTube recently, and there's a couple of channels that I've been watching, American or North American truckers. They're Canada and the United States, continental USA, so North America in general, and one of them is Trucker Josh. He's out of Winnipeg and Manitoba. And I think in the last month or so, he has bought a truck. He's become an owner-operator, and he's bought a Freightliner with a Daimler engine in it and an automatic gearbox, I believe. And he is still working for Keystone Shipping. It's a shipping company, but they're employing him as an owner-operator to shift their gear and move their jobs. So I've been watching his channel for quite a while, silently or quietly, checking him in and checking out every so often. I didn't find his channel when it was originally started. I came in much later. But I was watching him before he grew his beard, so if that's any indicator. But that's kind of interesting to see, because he's a straight down fella. He's got a dog called Diesel in the cab, and you know, there's always a bit of stuff going on. Some of his videos are quite funny. Got a good sense of humor, but he also shows you what's going on, and the road that he's driving, the trucks that he's driving, the experiences that make up his typical day. And it is interesting, actually. And he drives Canada and the USA. You know, and there's quite a few little characteristic things that, you know, I don't think he's contrived at all. I think they're really him. For instance, Tim Horton's coffee is Timmy's coffee, and he's big on Timmy's coffee, and so he makes quite a bit of fun out of that. And I think he's even got one of those capsule coffee percolator jobs, which he's even got his Timmy's coffee in capsules that he can have a Timmy's in the truck, even down south USA. So, you know, it's all that kind of good fun. But you also get to see him when he's at home, and you get to see him in his car, and you actually get to see quite a significant amount of his life. Both what it's like, and I guess what the realities are and what he misses. So if you have a bit of time and you're interested in trucking, go go and have a look at Trucker Josh. Trucker Josh and Diesel, which is his Rottweiler Border Collie something or other cool dog. The other channel that I was watching, which again is a trucking channel, North America, is called the Jade and John Show, or the John and Jade Show. Not sure which way it was now, actually. But this is a trucking trio, in all due respect. There's three life forms in the cab. There's a little dog that Jade and John have. Obviously, they're the other two. They're a married couple, and they are company drivers, but they're, you know, a driving pair, whatever that's called. So they clock the miles because, you know, one of them is driving, the other one is sleeping, and they switch over. So that truck is turning the wheels, and they're crisscrossing the California to Florida and all the states in between on a fairly regular basis. But you also get to see their life outside of the truck, and they're a funny couple. They're quirky in a good way. They have their own personalities, and they have their own what's the word? Beliefs is the wrong word, but you know, their own styles of life. John has blueberries and a banana and almond milk with vanilla, and made a great point of explaining that the vanilla almond milk is the one to go for. But he has that every morning in the truck, and you know, it's kind of, he starts his videos the same way all the time, with "Good morning, internet. I just got up 30 minutes ago," and then the camera pans down to a bowl of frozen blueberries, a banana, and his vanilla flavored Almond Milk. Which in and of itself is nothing amazing, but it's just kind of funny that it's the same thing every morning, and he loves it, and it's all good. And of course, in the driving seat is Jade, who is just a real character. She's a really confident lady, knows what she's doing, and has a wicked sense of humor as well, and the two of them complement each other quite well. But you also get to see them, like I said, outside of the cabin. They've been, you get to see some of the work that they've done on their house, that they're it's a fixer-upper that is becoming, you know, inside is just looking awesome now. And, you know, they're not bearing their souls to the world, but they're not kind of, you know, putting up an image either. You really get to see who and what they are and how they're choosing to live their lives. And you know, they got their stresses and they've got their job to do, and it's tiring and it pulls on them and all the rest, but they're a really positive kind of couple and strangely entertaining. A little bit kind of the attraction, I think, with both the trucker Josh and Diesel, and then the John and Jay and little Lil Bug or whatever the dog's name is. You know, both of their channels, it's kind of a little like you get to be a fly on the wall. You get to see how other people live. It's a little, there's a word in English and I don't know it, or I do know it, but I can't think of it. You know, it's a little nosy. It's, I think the word begins with P, but for the life of me, I can't place it in my head. And it probably doesn't begin with P. Now that I usually, when I can't think of a word, and then I think it begins with a letter. That's not true. It's some other number or some other letter. But I do recommend checking them out as well, because they've got a lot of videos up there. They've got, you know, way over 100. Both of them do, maybe 200. I don't know, I don't think it's 200 for the John and Jade show, but they're way, way, way over 100. And, you know, they put up a video most every day, every week, you know, so there's 30 minutes or 25 minutes or 35 minutes or whatever it is of something going on. And it's kind of funny because I find myself checking out their channel every other day, bit like a kind of your soap opera traditional model on your TV, you know, you kind of getting home to see the next episode or whatever. That's kind of how I'm viewing their videos. They put a lot of work into them, I think, behind the scenes, and you don't maybe always get to see how much they do put in. I mean, big rig talking or big rig trucking is a third Canadian trucker that I'm subscribed to as well, that I go and check out every so often. And Jerry Ott is the driver, and another interesting character, another guy who's prepared to explain, I guess, the ins and outs of the trucking business from his perspective. And I bet some of this stuff is going to be really useful information for prospective drivers, you know. And I think these people are doing huge service to folks that are up and coming and they're considering the career, because prior to the likes of YouTube, you know, it was a kind of a work experience type of deal that was difficult to come by unless you knew somebody in the industry. And you know, it's one thing if your dad's a trucker and you're doing a ride along. It's another thing if you're really interested in trucking, but nobody around you is trucking, and you kind of, you know, you've got to go and break that ground yourself and find somebody who's going to let you in and see the reality of it. And I wonder, did you ever get to truly see the reality of it, or did you just get a view and then, when you decided to give it a shot, you got the rest? Now with these guys, you don't get 100%, But you get a lot, and they bear a lot too. You know, you get to see the emotion, you get to see the good news reactions, the bad news reactions, and everything in between. And like recently, the John and Jade, their truck broke down. I think they said it got hit by lightning, but it was coming up with spurious electric errors all over the place, and I think the Mekis were, you know, pulling it into the garage and chasing their tail for a while, and I think they've kind of resolved that the truck is troublesome now. And but they were at home for a long time, way over a week, and I think they have some kind of penalty money that they or not penalty money, but it's not their penalty, it's off the road kind of money, downtime money, whatever, you know. They're, but it's not anything like what they should normally be earning if they're turning the miles out. And the last episode had them packing up out of the old truck, now that the decision was made that they were going to move truck and get a new truck. Tell ya, you should see what they pulled out of the cab of their Cascadia. It was like, how do you fit that much stuff in there? Plus two people, plus you know, plus the dog is a little dog, but you know, needed space, and every little nook and cranny is being used in there. And of course, it doesn't surprise me actually when I think about it, because that truck is their home for 2 week and longer periods of time without break, you know. They don't get to go to their bricks and mortar house or their wood frame house, whatever it is, all that often, you know. So if you don't have it in the truck, you don't have it in the truck, but you don't have it, or you don't have access to it. So they had a couple of fold-up bikes in there, and they had, you know, all of their normal day-to-day stuff in there, and computers and cables and so on and so forth, and they pulled it all out, and I tell you, it was like, holy cow. They had it on the ground outside the truck, you know, all boxed up, ready to be moved. And it was a lot of stuff. I'm thinking, geez. And I don't think there was food and stuff in there either. I mean, that's extra, you know, the water, space, and all the rest. So that was kind of an interesting insight to what it's like if you're a trucker in the U.S. and what would be expected to be in a dual team's cab, and the trouble, or the inconvenience, I suppose is the right word. It's the lesser of two evils, because I think they would prefer to be driving. So given that their company has said, listen, your old truck is through no fault of your own, I guess, is off the road, we're going to give you another truck, the inconvenience is acceptable, because they want to drive, and this is how they're going to be able to drive. But I don't think the other truck was being delivered to them. They had to go to the other truck, which is 12 hours or 10 hours or 11 hours or, you know, I think it was that kind of, excuse me, it was that kind of distance away. So they had to get a rental car to make that trip up, and they could store anything they wanted into the rental car to bring it up. But of course, they couldn't fit everything that they had in the old truck. And they were saying before they changed, and they had to kind of leave stuff behind, throw it away, or give it away, or, you know, it was gone. They couldn't bring it. They couldn't bring it. Now they had their own personal vehicle that they brought, a van, which they were able to store the stuff they couldn't fit into the rental car. And the rental car was just a regular sedan. It wasn't anything fancy, or spacious, I mean. So that's like a lot of inconvenience and quite a bit of stress. And Like, hell, I moved house enough times in my life. I don't ever want to do it again. You know, they're probably facing another move. If they're unlucky, it'll be sooner than later. And if they're lucky, it'll be later than sooner. But it is probably coming within their driving career. So, yeah, that just was an interesting insight. And of course it is with some anticipation now that I'm looking to see their next videos and find out what truck they get and see if they like it and see if it works out for them and so on and so forth, you know? It is compelling viewing to a certain extent. And the episodes are nice and short, so you can easily get through it without needing to set aside as much time as you might need to for a, you know, for a TV program episode. Plus you can watch it anytime you like. It's not on a set schedule. So the same is true with Trucker Josh, because he's bought his truck, like I said, so it's kind of interesting and compelling viewing to see how he's getting on with it you know, how it's working out for him. And with Big Rig Trucking, you know, I actually haven't been watching some of his stuff for a little while now. I checked out one of his videos recently where he was having a hard time with some of the more immature of the community that were dropping rubbish comments and stuff onto some of his videos, which, yeah, he was kind of having a bit of a rant at them, saying grow up and cop on, which if he doesn't say it, they never get told it. But by saying it, I don't know if he's necessarily going to change anything. I haven't watched any of his on the road videos for a little while, just because I'm still subscribed to his channel. So, you know, when I get back to him, which I will, I'll be able to sit down and go through, you know, a whole load of stuff. And his wife also has made a few appearances on videos, and again, I haven't watched for a little while now, so I don't know what's happened there. So, trucking videos, if you're interested in it, there's stuff to watch. And I've only mentioned three that I've chosen to subscribe to because I find them interesting. I've actually subscribed to more than three, but these are the three that I'm more... excuse me, I'm having just unstoppable yawns at the moment, so I think I'm going to have to pull over in the next kind of game hour and call it a day anyway. But these are the three video channels or the three YouTube channels that I'm most interested in watching at the moment. Two of them very actively at the moment, and that'll round robin switch around, so they'll all get watched over the course of the longer term. So to be recommended. I've also been onto the IL2. I was on the IL2 server a little earlier. It's kind of good and bad news. It's actually good news. It's just a bit inconvenient. The servers are filling up. The ATAC server is maxed out, and I couldn't get on for a good 10 or 15 minutes tonight. It's got 100 people limit on there, and I think there is a little bit of a bottleneck regarding the Steam communications server with the you know, the actual hosting server from ATAC. But once you get up to 100 people anyway, that's kind of what the server is designed to handle and no more. So you kind of have to patiently keep checking in to see if somebody leaves and you can get in. And sure enough, I did. Just had a bit of patience. It was the second time that I flew tonight, and it just felt, again, more smooth, and there was a patch that was released at the beginning of the week or on Tuesday, and I'm convinced in my own style of playing that I'm seeing it as a Excuse me, I'm really yawning now. As a very smooth experience, plane physics, the flight model maybe has been tweaked and improved on here and there, minor ways or not, I don't know. I guess some of it is that I'm getting more used to the game. I've been playing it a lot, and I've begun to, you know, consider pushing it to formation flying and those kind of things. Which is, you know, progress, and it's good. But also tonight, you know, I started getting hits on aircraft that I'm not a very good pilot, and I've got a lot to learn. So it is a noteworthy step of progress when I talk about getting hits on, you know, other player aircraft. And I'm beginning to get that. I'm also still getting shot down, of course. And tonight I did an escort for some Blenheim bombers, which overall was a relatively quiet sortie. I managed to check out any contacts that we came across. They turned out to be friendly or didn't see us and not interested. And the bombs were dropped, and the Blennies got out, and we broke off I broke off their escort once they got back to friendly territory, and you know, I'm flying around enjoying myself, thinking this is pretty cool, and I'm still allowing an enemy to come back in on my six and get hits on me. So, you know, still learning, still making schoolboy errors, and probably have a little bit more of that to do, but genuinely convinced that the improvements in 4.3 are both the obvious improvements to the sound of the guns, or the changes to the rear gunners and the bombers, or the speed capabilities of the Allied aircraft, at least the Spitfires and the Hurricanes anyway, but also the more subjective feeling that, you know, things have been improved here nicely, and wow, it's just mind-blowingly cool for a game that was literally put on the shelf of shame and disappointment, to now be, quite frankly, the standard against which most of all flight sims are being measured against is really quite an achievement, and kudos goes to the Team Fusion mod team for everything that they've managed to achieve. It's been truly awesome. And I say that not lightly, because they're not finished. They've got these plans. We have 26 minutes of driving left. That should get me to a fuel station, I'm hoping. Of course it might not. Let's have a quick look at the map here. Oh, Jesus, we've got a bit to go. We're dropping off here now, so 19 minutes. We might be okay. We do have a bit to go, though, to get to that fuel station. But once we drop off and get around, I'll have a look, and we might roll in on time. Or we will incur a penalty. Come on, green car. Accelerate. Okay, 4 minutes. 4 minutes. Apparently I'm getting tired, and the this is a bit tight. 1 minute, so never looked in the mirror there, did I? We can push this up to maximum speed, but I believe I will not be able to get there in time, and I am going to incur a penalty. Which is crap, but anyway. That's the crossing, so I've got a couple of bins to go and I should see a sign of services. That's those bins over with, so I'm expecting around the next one or two bins to soon see a services sign. Oh, I see it already. And it is 500 meters. So we will be borderline here. That's the second warning that I've got. I don't think I'm going to get many more. There is the fuel station. Red car is coming up. On the inside. I'm hammering through here, full throttle. Let's see if I can get ourselves landed before I get a warning. I'm coming in very hot here. But... Ah! Yes! We did it. No fines. Fantastic. Well, that's it, folks, for now. His returning empty fuel and maintenance costs are 492. He does a lot of that returning empty. Let's pop out and just see what the log is for this guy, because I don't know what to make of it. Hans, who does dishes, is softer than Gervais with the lime green hairy lip squid. Here's the log, and there's some good jobs on there as well, but there's quite a few minuses. There's minus 844, minus 421, minus 337, and now a minus 490, as well as another minus 829. So he's like, he's not really doing great, is he? He's supposed to be fairly decent. He's supposed to be 3.3, so... He's bringing in 519 a day positive, so that's at least something. And we are making money here, so... Yeah. We'll keep him for now, I guess, and see if he'll develop any better. Okay, folks, well, that's it. Catch you next time. Until then, go handy.